One of the important and most critical aspects of investing in the stock market is answering the question, know thyself. You have to decide whether you're an investor and a speculator. And as such, you have to decide what type of companies you're willing to invest in. For example, if you're an investor, investing in a very cyclical stock like Methanex really turns into speculating in a cyclical stock like Methanex. Because what you can see here by looking at the company's historical operating results is that earnings growth is very, very inconsistent over time. There are periods where earnings rise and then collapse, rise and then collapse. And then when you look at trying to come up with how you would forecast the future, when you look at forecasts and then check the analyst scorecard, you find out that analysts are wrong on the estimates. In other words, they can't be relied upon. So are you an investor or a speculator? Hello, everybody. This is Chuck Carnevale, co-founder of FASTgraphs, the Fundamentals Analyzer software tool, AKA Mr. Valuation, once again bringing you another Subscriber Request Tuesday video. However, before I go on with this video, I have an announcement of sorts to make. You know, I've been struggling with this series since I've been doing it. I've actually enjoyed doing it, and I've got some good response from you, the subscribers to our channel, and many of our subscribers of FASTgraphs. But it's really kind of become tiring because what I'm finding out is that number one is you guys ask for too many individual stocks. And then you also, that leads to asking me about stocks that I don't know very much about, which then requires me to spend a lot of time trying to research those stocks. So I've been thinking about this for quite some time, and I've been limiting my subscriber request series to like 10 or 12 stocks, although I'm getting 20, 30, 40 requests every week. But I thought I would change things up here a little bit going forward. I still want to come to you and find out what you guys are really interested in, what you want to know as investors. And that's where I think I can bring the most benefit by sharing my knowledge and experience over the last five decades of being an investor and being an analyst of stocks and also being the co-developer of FASTgraphs, the Fundamentals Analyzer software tool that focuses primarily on valuation, fundamentals first, stock prices second. So what I'm going to do with this series, I'm going to ask you to continue to participate, but instead of asking to see individual stocks, I'm going to ask you to go ahead and ask me about principles of investing that you may be confused about or would like to know more about. Like, for example, the benefits of dividends, the value of dividends, how you can tell if a stock is overvalued, undervalued, or fairly valued, how you can tell a good company from a bad company, how you can know when to invest, when to buy, and when to sell. These are all important questions, and I'm going to leave it up to you to play around with that and see if we can come up with some suggestions for future subscriber request Tuesdays. I'm going to continue to do videos on Tuesday, but I'm not going to try to cover individual stocks that you asked about. I'm sorry, it just becomes too unwieldy, and I hope you all understand. So this will be my last in that series, and today I'm going to look at an interesting group of stocks that you've asked to see here. I've got nine stocks that I'm going to be covering. And what I want you to notice here about these nine stocks, there's, you know, information technology is a sector that everybody's interested in, everybody asks me about. We've got one healthcare stock here, two material stocks, consumer discretionary, and one consumer staples. And what's interesting about this group of stocks here is that these stocks come in all different flavors, all different types, and all different styles. And I discussed that when I looked at Methanex. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to kind of segue into this subscriber request Tuesday. And I'm going to just focus on, you know, how to analyze a stock, how to look at a stock, especially if you're a FASTgraphs subscriber, and talk a little bit about things that I think are important to look at. For example, if I look at Autodesk, I noticed that the company's always been profitable except during 2017 and 2018. Which was, you know, kind of the area just before COVID where all of a sudden the company lost money. It's an application software company, and it had, you know, really a couple of bad years here where they actually had negative earnings. So the earnings were lost, but earnings have been dropping for several years in a row. And now all of a sudden they turn into this spurt of earnings growth. So the point is, when you're looking at companies, I think it's important to know what the history of the business was, how well it did. Like when I used that first intro stock that I covered, next year, I showed you how cyclical it was. Well, here's another one, Autodesk. Is this company now a growth stock? the last several years, I want you to see that earnings growth has been spectacular. Autodesk is expected to continue growing at about 23% a year, but I would argue that the stock is still highly priced. Now, when you look at the analyst scorecard, you see that the analysts have been wrong on this company usually half the time or more. In a one-year forecast, you know, they're generally wrong. So what that tells me is this is a very difficult company to forecast. And you can see that by looking at it. It almost makes sense by looking at the history. But here's the point I want to cover on this first stock. It's a growth stock. Notice that there's no dividends. You know, the company's not paying any dividends at all. You know, the dividend yield is zero, obviously. So it's always about capital appreciation. Now, the stock got very lofty in terms of valuation with PEs, you know, over 65 times earnings. But since that time, the stock has corrected from a price in the upper 300s down into under 200. That's about at least a third drop here in a very short period of time. Now, the question is, has the stock become inexpensive or not? Now, based on its long-term history, and this is a point I want to make here, the stock still looks very, very expensive to me. Based on a shorter-term history with a stronger growth rate, it starts to look more reasonable. And based on just the last several years, and I need to shorten this so I get a period, it actually looks inexpensive. Because, you know, since 2019, if you will, beginning of 2020, the end of 2019, this stock has been growing by over 40% a year. It's expected to continue growing at over 23% a year. So this might have, you know, be a leopard that changed its spot, so to speak. As I always say, that's where, you know, continuous research comes in. It's a triple B rated company. So in essence, it's investment grade. It has 70% debt to capital, which is very, very high level of debt. You need to take that into consideration. And, you know, it's now time to research, is this company going to continue to grow at these fast rates? But the point is, you can have different perspectives about this company by looking at the different time periods. Just don't go by the statistics alone, you know, the things like the PE ratio, et cetera. Look at what the company's potential is, what its most recent developments have been, and whether or not you believe that those developments are going to persist or change, be different or be the same, et cetera, et cetera. So that's our very first choice here was Autodesk. Now, Akamai Technologies is another very interesting technology stock. Akamai is, you know, internet services and infrastructure. It helps people, you know, customers, you know, get faster internet speeds and more efficient internet usage. And this has been a pretty good company. Now, I've gotten no growth rate here because I had negative numbers. You can't calculate growth from a negative number. So what I've got to do is I've got to call out a couple of years, C-U-L-L, try to come up with the growth rate. So it's been growing at approximately 10% since 2008, and the fiscal year here is calendar fiscal year. It's somewhat inconsistent, but yet somewhat consistent. In other words, every now and then we have the occasional down year, and we have, you know, growth rates that are sometimes single digit, growth rates sometimes double digit, and so on. We even have some negative growth rates. So it's, you know, again, a very difficult company to forecast. No dividend yield, once again. It normally trades at a high multiple of around 20 times earnings over this period. It's now significantly below that. Looking at the future, and you always want to check the future, Akamai is expected to only grow at about 4 or 5% for the next couple of years. The long-term growth rate is expected to be about 12%. Again, I'm trying to come up with some rational thoughts about this company. How can I analyze this company? Well, I look at the analyst scorecard. It has a really good analyst scorecard. So that simply means the analysts have been accurate much of the time. So when I'm looking at this, I can almost have, you know, high level of confidence that the analysts are probably correct. So when I look at forecasting here with this stock, it looks like it's reasonably priced, not cheap, not expensive. It does have, you know, some growth potential. However, the rate of return is only expected to be about 3 or 4% per year. Now, if I look at the normal multiple that the market applies, I get a much higher number, like 19 or 20%. The question is, am I willing to continue to accept these high valuations? As you can see, the stock does very often go back down into what I would call more reasonable PEs. This is more of a speculative growth stock than it is a, you know, really what I would call quality long-term investment. Now, AMN Healthcare Services is an interesting company. They do staffing. Coming out of COVID, as everyone knows, that the healthcare industry had struggled to get good quality people. There was a nursing shortage, et cetera. And this company's business obviously did extremely well for a couple of years. We see these very strong earnings growth rates from 2021 of 130%, followed by 29%. The analysts expect that to stabilize and earnings are expected to drop. But I want you to notice, if I connected a line from here to here, you can see that would be kind of the trend line of more normalized earnings growth, which is about 8 or 9 or 10% a year. So when I'm looking at forecasting, I see negative growth because it's going back down to a more normal growth rate. The long-term growth is expected to be about 8%, which is the company's quote-unquote normal historical growth rate. So I see this company kind of going back to normalcy, if you will. And so then the question becomes, is it cheap or is it expensive? And if you looked at it from a long-term growth point of view, looking at a blended PE of about 14.6, it probably is reasonably priced, if not slightly undervalued on that basis. If you look at it from a normal PE multiple, again, the same thing. It normally trades at around 18 times earnings. So an 18 PE ratio would make it look even more undervalued on a long-term growth rate. If I looked at long-term growth rate and went to an 18 PE, then, you know, I'd have a double-digit rate of return. But once again, we're dealing with a stock that pays no dividend, but yet notice how the stock price has tracked earnings and notice the somewhat cyclicality. Again, I want to check the earnings scorecard. It has a pretty decent scorecard. I'd be looking at this company from a practical, logical point of view of being a company that's kind of going back to more normalized growth for whatever that is in the future than what we've had here in the very, very recent past. Methanex is one I covered. This is a commodity chemical company. Just look how cyclical this stock is and how difficult it is. Now, let me show you something here very interesting. If I looked at the long-term growth rate, now consider that the stock was generating about 80 cents worth of earnings back in 2002. So earnings levels were very, very low. So if I bought it here and held it to here, and I looked at my performance over that period of time, I would find out that it, you know, had very, very good performance. Performance was very good because I bought it at a low valuation. But if I shorten that time frame to a more cyclical time frame and look at performance, it dramatically underperformed. So don't just rely on historical numbers. To me, if you're looking at performance, it's important to know how the performance was created. Was it pure growth? Was it a combination of valuation and growth? Was it hurt by high valuation? Was it hurt by cyclicality? These are all questions you should be asking yourself when you look at it investing in any company. You want to be looking at, you know, what you can prudently recognize. Now, here's PACCAR, and this is another interesting one I wanted to show you because it's a pretty cyclical company. It's a large trucker. If I go to my external links here, many of you would know this company from, you know, some of its most, you know, famous products, some of the things like Kenworth, Peterbilt. You know, these are some of their most recognized brands as far as cars, but they also make all kinds of other parts that you might not be so familiar with. But here's the thing. The company is now going on a transition, if you will, that they're going into electric trucks, heavy trucks. So that's going to change things dramatically. But once again, very cyclical company, very erratic dividend record. I'm the type of investor that doesn't like that. I want to see as much predictability and as much consistency as I possibly can see in a company because that gives me much more confidence in being able to forecast what the future investment results would be. As a result of all that cyclicality, the company still has a pretty good analyst scorecard. So if even considering all the cyclicality, the analysts are pretty well, you know, they pretty well seem to understand this company and how it generates, you know, revenue. But I would, you know, pay attention to the fact the company offers a dividend yield of 1.6%. It does look undervalued right now. But once again, it has a very spotty dividend record. And, you know, it has a pretty good growth record of double-digit growth. But you're going to have to go through periods of time where the stock really doesn't perform. Note that this long period of time here, we had about 5 or 6% performance. And if I adjusted that, you know, down to, say, the bottom, towards the bottom of COVID, it drops to 4 or 5%. It's important that you're aware of what you're investing in my opinion, when you're investing in these companies. The next stock I want to look at is Polaris. This is actually a dividend king. offers a 2.3% dividend yield, looks very, very inexpensive today, has an excellent dividend record. They ran into some inventory issues back here in 2015 and 16, which caused their earnings to drop or almost be cut in half, but they recovered very nicely. The company's stock price fell dramatically during COVID, but then recovered very quickly. It's currently on sale, and it's very cheap. You know, looking at the company forecasting, expected to grow at around 12.5%. The analyst scorecard is quite good. Their analysts are right, or they beat estimates most of the time. The areas where they had some trouble was during that inventory shortage. Otherwise, they've got a pretty unblemished record. This would be a very interesting choice today. Great consistent dividend record and long-term performance compared to the S&P 500 has been quite good, despite the fact that it's undervalued today in the stock market. I would consider to be and generally overvalued, although, you know, we're getting a lot better value in the market today than we've had in a long, long time. The next stock I'm going to look at is one that's, I think, very, very interesting. And this is the kind of thing that I've taught myself looking at investing in stocks for a long period of time, is that you need to know the nature of the beast. And what I mean by that, there are certain kind of companies that have pretty much historical records. There's automobile manufacturers, things like utilities. And one that you can almost count on are commodity companies, especially heavy metal. They tend to be very, very cyclical, very, very erratic. Their dividend records tend to be all over the place. They're very, very hard to have, you know, long-term confidence in, and you can't really be a long-term investor in these companies. As a result of that, their analyst scorecards are usually horrible. Analysts can't figure out how to forecast these companies either. So I don't really put much faith in what the forecasts are. You got to be careful with the statistics as a result, because you don't know if earnings are going to be collapsing, dividends are going to be collapsing, or what. I would call this stock cheap today. Offers a very high dividend yield, assuming the dividend is, you know, reasonably safe. And there I'd want to go and look at things like cash flows and so on. The cash flow record is a little better than the earnings record. But when I was investing in this stock, I wouldn't be naive. I would be fully aware, again, of the nature of the beast, what type of stock it was. Now, here's one that's even more interesting than Methanex. If I looked at the long-term performance over this period of time here and compared it, it absolutely buried the S&P if I go back inception to date. So, you know, this kind of belies my statement that, you know, this is not a buy and hold stock. But there are long, long periods of time where you could have owned this stock and literally made no money. So if I shorten the time frame, now I get a totally different perspective even, where the company underperformed the market by a significant amount. So again, don't just look at things like historical performance and make your decisions. Know why and how that historical performance was manifest. Know the nature of the companies you're investing in. And don't just look at the numbers. Look at what caused the numbers. Try to understand why the company generated the results that it did. Now here's Sprouts Farmers Market. Our consumer staple, if you will. Pretty good company, got double-digit growth, was very, very highly hyped and popular. And I want you to notice for a long period of time here, for, you know, most of its first, you know, 6 or 7 years in business, it actually generated negative rates of return to its shareholders, no dividends. It's kind of corrected and become reasonably inexpensive after that. The company's forecast to grow about 6% going forward. It does trade at a very low P.E. ratio. Analysts have had a good record on forecasting this company. But my point is that the culprit here, the reason it's been a poor performer, is not because the business hasn't done well. It's because the market put an outlandish price on this stock and did that for a long period of time. If this is the kind of company you like, you know, it is a growth stock, no dividend again, this would be probably a decent time to invest in it. With a good record, you could, you know, possibly earn double-digit returns going forward, because Sprouts Market looks inexpensive to me today as a quote-unquote non-dividend paying type growth stock. Anyway, that's all I got for you today. This has been Chuck Carnevale. I want to say thank you for watching the video. If you like this video, give me a like, ring the bell, subscribe to the channel, of course, and subscribe to FASTgraphs if you haven't already. The one thing that this tool gives you, and I tried to emphasize that in today's video, is the ability to look at a business from a business perspective, to recognize how well that business has been run, how well it's been able to perform in the marketplace, whether it's, you know, what kind of characteristics it has, you know, how easy it is to evaluate and analyze, And of course, as always, there's no substitute for comprehensive research and due diligence. FASTgraphs should provide the first step, in my opinion, in anybody's research effort because it gives you more information about the business behind the stock that you're investing in. Thanks for watching. I'll talk to you guys again real soon. Thanks.